All right. Welcome back, everybody. Sports Chat 503. Happy Thanksgiving, everybody. Man, my voice is still shattered from that Arizona game, but I'll take it. This week, Uncle Phil, the man, the myth, the legend, turns 80 years old. And you know what? Just want to give a thanks to Uncle Phil. Thank you. Got to have a conversation with Uncle Phil at the Alamo Bowl. Before D'Anthony ran it back. Really awesome. Both from Southeast Portland, he and I. How about that? That's where the comparisons end. Okay, how about this thing? Let's talk about Duck basketball, folks. Man, this is a little bit late, but I kind of wanted to see this team before I did a review. It was hard to do a review before we really knew who these guys were. So, first time, long time, either way, I appreciate it. Obviously, coming from Portland, Oregon, and this is the week of PK80. We'll be going to games every day this week. Thursday, Friday, Saturday's the Civil War, and then, of course, Sunday for hopefully a championship game. Okay, I want to talk about a couple things here. One, a little breakdown of PK80, and then a little bit about what the preview looks like for our season this year for the Ducks, and then a little bit about recruiting. You know, we had the huge bowl news, and that pushes us up to the top upper echelon of the recruiting world, whatever recruiting stats you want to use, but it's in the top five everywhere, basically. So, and some people, it's the top number one. Feels good. Okay, so let's go ahead and break this thing down. First of all, PK80. PK80, very exciting time. I grew up with the Far West Classic out here, where we used to try to have 12 teams. I think it was 8. But my point is that this is a great time for holiday basketball, and Portland should be involved. Portland is a basketball hub, especially in the Northwest. Seattle's basketball hub as well. When it rains, man, you get in the gym out here. So we all grew up playing basketball, all part of the basketball community, love basketball. I grew up loving Duck basketball, probably even more than Duck football in the 80s. I was absolutely addicted to the Duck basketball because you get to get closer to them, you know. The Pit was rocking back then, and, you know, guys like Anthony Taylor and Tony Hargane that went both ways and, you know, played football and basketball, and, you know, Kofi Shea dunking at the end of the Reggie Miller game is probably my favorite Duck moment of my lifetime. Back in the day, Pitt was rocking, the scoreboard bouncing, everything. Good times, people. But we're in a whole new era. We got a brand new arena. Thank you to this guy right here, the Matt Knight Arena. So because we have a brand new arena that basically looks like a little mini Rose Garden, we're able to host a tournament like this. So the girls are playing in Eugene, the guys are playing up in Portland, and it's a great deal. UConn's out here, North Carolina, Duke, Oklahoma, Texas, Butler, great teams. Gonzaga's from out here. And they get to play teams like Portland State, Portland. But we are in this, and we might be able to get to play North Carolina in a showdown, which would be amazing. Because remember back in the spring during the Final Four when Oregon only lost by 1 point to North Carolina? And then North Carolina went on to win the championship. So it feels like Ducks are really close. So it feels awesome. It feels good. So let's go ahead and break this thing down a little bit for this season. This season we have basically one returning player, Peyton Pritchard, who is awesome. Had a great year last year as a freshman. Was an amazing, amazing high school player out here. Went 4-for-4 with state championships. That doesn't happen very often. Guy is awesome. So I really like how he plays. I really like how forward he is. He really drives the ball. He drives and kicks a lot. He's a true point guard. Only shoots when he needs to. And now we've got a lot of scoring help on this team, starting with Troy Brown. This is the guy. Now, a lot of people say one and done here, and I've talked with my dad a bunch about this one. I kind of think that he might have, depending on the season, obviously, but he might have an opportunity to be here for 2 years. One and done is obviously the hook, and that's the key thing right now. And if he goes, well, then that's fine. In the press conference getting bowl, Dana Altman talked about how the idea that Oregon couldn't do one-and-ones very well was somehow used against them in the recruiting process, which is kind of crazy to think about, but it is what it is. You got to use any advantage possible. So I really think that this is a kid who might be able to change the game on that one. He looks very, very smooth, very smooth. Silky scorer, but really pretty good defensively and a real good strong body, 6'7" and all of it, 215, looks like a real prototype basketball player and looks like an NBAer. Don't know if he's an NBAer right now, and again, that transition for some of those NBA guys can be difficult. for some guys, it can be relatively easy. This is a guy I think it's going to be easier for. He reminds me of a guy who is basically built, carbon copy built for the NBA. His outside-inside game, his defensive prowess, his kind of attack on the glass, all those things work. Kenny Wooten is the other guy. Kenny Wooten, this is a guy who has some big shoes to fill, literally. Has kind of two shoes to fill. Jordan Bell was the guy in the middle. And this is Kenny Wooten's kind of trying to fill his spot. So you got two freshmen starting, coming in, and basically handing the keys to these guys. Wooten's 6'9", 220, real good rim protector, pretty good back-to-the-basket player, and he's going to get his buckets for sure. Peyton Pritchard type of point guard really works with a guy like Kenny Wooten. Kenny Wooten needs a point guard like Pritchard who's always looking to pass the ball, always looking to get the open guy, and especially always looking to dump it down. This is not an era where we dump it down to the post anymore. Now everybody's five out, everybody's kicking, everybody's driving and kicking, everybody's shooting the three. Even big men are now all shooting the three. Look at Boucher last year. One of the reasons why they said they got Bol Bol was because of the Boucher tape and because Boucher could stretch the floor so much and was encouraged to get in the corner and shoot threes, and then he could come on defense and protect the rim. That's exactly what Bol Bol wants to do. He doesn't want to be down low in the post doing post moves. He wants to be out attacking, kind of like Kristaps Porzingis, and then he wants to be in the middle and be able to kind of deflect and defend the rim. So I think that's a really nice deal. MJ Cage, man, Michael Cage's son. I've really hoped a lot for Michael Cage's son. I loved Michael Cage as a kid. Seattle Supersonics, Jerry Curl was flowing. One of my favorite players in the NBA. Really, really, really good player. Really underrated player. Not in the West Coast, not Pacific Northwest. We knew who that guy was. But this is a guy who, as a redshirt freshman, he's 6'10". He's all of it, 225. This is a guy who can really change the game. He's come off the bench, played a little bit, seen a couple minutes of him. He's kind of played some garbage time, but this is a guy who could be really successful this year. Kind of playing similar to Keith Smith last year. Maybe not that many minutes, but could be some really important minutes. You never know. Okay, Elijah Brown, guard. Woo-hoo-hoo-hoo. This is the guy that comes from New Mexico. This is the guy who's instant offense. This is the guy who can score right now. This is the guy they took on the trips to Media Day and all that sort of stuff. He's the real deal, and to get him as a redshirt senior, to get him as a transfer player, is great because you need some depth and you need some veteran leadership. This is a very young team. So to be able to get a new player, but a veteran player, very, very important, very important. And I think he's going to be a real scorer down the road. I think he's going to really help this team. Victor Bailey Jr., you know, again, freshman, a little bit leaner, 6'4", 185. Kid can score good defensively. I think the key for sometimes there's going to be a backlog here. When you get this recruiting class that's coming in this year, you get a recruiting class that's coming in next year, there's going to be a backlog. There's only five positions on the floor. There's only one ball. So you're going to have to deal with this. I think he might be one of these guys to deal with this less than the other guys. Okay, so he might not get as much playing time, but you know what? Again, just like Keith Smith did last year, might get really quality minutes in really quality games. Speaking of Keith Smith, I really like this kid from Seattle. Really, really important player. 6'7", smooth operator. Kind of, you know, he can shoot the ball, he can defend, but he kind of has that NBA look to him, to me. He doesn't have that takeover ability, but his body type, the way he plays the game, is very, very smooth, very fluid. Really like what this kid offers. Rainier Beach, one of the best high schools in the country, in my opinion, out here in the Northwest. We really love it, so it is what it is there. He's going to get some quality minutes this year. Got Paul White, redshirt junior. Again, not going to get that many minutes, but he is going to play some. He's a big dude, 6'9", 225. He can post from Chicago. Georgetown, but the idea is with this guy is that, you know, again, there's going to be some minutes available, some minutes not. I think this is a team that's going to have a lot of wing players. You're going to have like three or four wings on the floor at a time, so sometimes you're not going to have a lot of room for posts. We didn't have that last year. We had Jordan Bell as the main guy, and there were three or four guards wings on the floor, basically. You've got Evan Gross. He's playing off the bench. He'll be a practice player, and then you've got McIntosh. I really like McIntosh a lot. He shoots the ball deep. He's 6'7". He can stroke it. He's got the body. He's a redshirt senior as well. Illinois State. again, he can score right now. He knows how to play the game because he's been in basketball this long. He's been in college basketball. So, and then you've got basically the rest of the run is basically Sorkin, you know, from what I've seen so far. I haven't seen a lot of Will Johnson. Haven't seen a lot of Abu Khabib, but I'm Sorkin played a little bit last year. Again, kind of garbage time, but this is a guy 6'10", can protect the rim. He's 230, and he's gotten bigger. He looks different this year than he did last year. Body type looks different. Game looks different. He's attacking the rim a little bit better, but he can shoot the three as well. So that's what I think on this team with the roster. I think it's a big deal. And then you're talking about this recruiting class. This recruiting class is huge. Bol Bol is the top of the deal. Will Richardson, Lewis King, Miles Norris are these guys. And again, you only got one guard. All these guys are 6'7". All these guys are 6'9". Bol Bol 7'2". I mean, but again, you're talking about the game is changing. The game is going to much more wing players. Everybody looks like Jerry Stackhouse. Everybody looks like Vince Carter out there. And then you have one guard. I mean, it's wild. It's wild. It's five out. It's everybody's cutting. Altman, everybody comes to the middle. You kind of have those two semicircles going on in there. And you have that constant upper top of the key where you have the high post and you have that available, but the high post is maybe 6'9 at the most. You know, you got a guy like Bol Bol, he's not even going to be that guy. He's going to be in the corner like Boucher was. So very, very, very interesting. I'm a big fan of Dana Altman. Got the 600th win. Dana's one of the most underrated coaches. He's been out here long enough now. He's really got it going. We got Elite Eights. We've got Final Four last year, which was just absolutely epic. To lose by 1 point to the championship team, that's just something special there. And I love North Carolina. Got a lot of respect for them. To have that situation happen last year was just absolutely epic. You follow that up this year with this PK80 to start the year. You get some really good cred there, maybe some RPI numbers that you normally wouldn't get a chance to get in the first little part of the season. And then you can jump into this regular season. This season, let's talk about it a little bit. I think you're basically talking about Oregon in the north. I don't know much about Washington. Last year, losing Romar is a big deal. I don't know about Washington State. Ernie Kent feels like they're right in the middle of the pack. Yeah, they have some good players sometimes, but it feels like their whole season over time, they just can't get it done. Stanford's always Stanford. They always have some great players. They always have some bigs. They always have a couple scorers. They always have a real pretty nice player scoring-wise. They always have some guards. Cal is always interesting because O'Martin, really interesting coach. I'm a big fan of his. He has some really great players down in there, so they could be a challenger. Oregon State got Tinkle's kid back finally, but I don't know how long Tinkle's going to be there. Anderson left this year for the football program. I don't know how long Tinkle can keep the thing rolling. They're in the old barn. Everybody's getting new gyms. Everybody's getting new stuff, and they've still got the old stuff, so I don't know about Oregon State. So it really looks to me like Oregon's going to win the North. And maybe Cal in there. And then the South is just all about Arizona. Arizona's the just crown jewel, right? Well, then you've got USC. USC's kind of everybody's darling this year. You know, you've got, you know, USC is just an awesome squad, you know. And then Benny Boatwright, you know, obviously we don't know about then Shimezi Metsu. And I mean, this is a good team. They're big too. They're big and they can run. Arizona's got everybody's darling because they got everybody's best players every year, you know, but they're under a little bit of heat with this NCAA violation stuff. USC is under a little bit of heat with that NCAA violation stuff. Hopefully, Oregon's not in that same exact situation, but it is what it is. Other than that, let's call it good. So I think that Arizona, I think USC is the teams in the South. And then other than that, it's just it's a crapshoot. Who's gonna play in the South? I think Utah and Colorado are pretty good. Arizona State is always a tough battle there. Sometimes Arizona State has some good players. And then you never know what you're going to get out of UCLA. UCLA is kind of like the up and down, up and down, up and down. Hopefully they're going to be good because I think it's very good for the conference if UCLA is good. But who knows how good they're going to be. So that's it. There's my Pac-10 preview. There's my recruiting. And there's the look at PK80. Happy Thanksgiving, everybody. Sports Chat 503. And don't remember, here I got to forget. Don't forget here. Thank you to Uncle Phil. All right, guys. Adios.